grace, mercy, and peace to you from our living God and from our risen Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Amen. Amen.
So today's lesson, those words from the Gospel of John, which I just read, are part of what's known as Jesus' last discourse, his final words to his disciples that he shares as part of the Last Supper, the night before he is crucified. In just a few hours, Jesus will be apprehended and arrested while praying on the Mount of Olives. Let us pray. Most gracious God, during those times in our lives when we're not quite certain what might happen next, we are given a promise. A promise that comes from you through your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. A promise that he will give us his peace. A peace that truly passes all human understanding. And so, Lord, we pray this day for that peace. I pray that peace upon every person gathered here this day. I pray that peace upon every member who is struggling. And I pray that peace upon every sister and brother throughout the world. The peace that comes from you through your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. In whose name we pray.
Amen.
Jesus knows what's about to happen. He knows what the trauma of the next few days will bring. So he provides his disciples with a parting promise. A parting promise that although he will no longer be with them, they will not be alone. That following him, the Lord will send the Holy Spirit, who will be their comforter and their advocate and their guide. And then Jesus gives these parting words, a benediction of sorts. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. I do not give as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid. These are the verses I want to focus on today. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. I do not give as the world gives. How do you understand that peace that Jesus gives? What do you think Jesus means when he says, peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you? How would you describe that peace of Christ? Anyone? Calming. Calming.
Comfort.
Comfort.
God is in control.
Lack of anxiety.
God is in control.
God is in control. Yeah. You know, oftentimes I think when we hear the word peace, at least the peace that the world talks about, we think that it's the lack of conflict or the lack of war, the absence of war. But the peace of Christ is a very different thing. The peace of Christ is broader and deeper and reaches to our very hearts and our very souls. In church, we pass the peace. And that's not simply a way of saying, gee, I hope you won't experience any conflict or war this week. But we mean something much deeper. In the benediction, I say, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord give you favor, look with you with favor, and give you peace. Our parting words, our sending words each and every Sunday are, go in peace, serve the Lord. This peace that Jesus talks about is obviously much more than the absence of war or conflict. It's more than my teenage daughters arguing with one another on the way to church this morning. It's more than a church conflict over the color of the carpet or the color of the walls. It's a peace that is much deeper. How many of you have seen the movie Miss Congeniality? with Sandra Bullock. She plays an undercover cop in a beauty pageant. And the local police have learned that there is something that's going to happen, and so they send her undercover as one of the contestants in this beauty pageant. And as you might imagine, when they get to that part in the beauty pageant where they ask the question, if you could be granted one wish, what would it be? There's always one contestant that says, world peace. And of course, everyone applauds and cheers. But you recognize that it's a very shallow answer. Because Jesus calls us to a different type of peace in the world. You see, the Gospel of John was written to Christians living under persecution. They'd been kicked out of the synagogue. They had worshiped there in the synagogue with their Jewish sisters and brothers, with their Jewish family members for years now after Jesus' death. But all of a sudden, they've been kicked out of the synagogue, and so you have family member against family member, much like some of our families might have experienced in the Civil War. They are living, these Christians, these early Christians, under Roman occupation. The Romans had a slogan, Pax Romana. They bragged about the peace they brought. Pax Romana, the peace of Rome. But when you really understand, the peace that the Romans brought was through war and conquest. The Roman Empire was peaceful only because they annihilated and obliterated any enemy that tried to stop them. That was the peace of the world to which Jesus was referring when he says, my peace I give to you, not as the world gives. In other words, it's not this shadowy, worldly peace. It is something much deeper, much broader. This peace is a gift from God. Typically, we experience peace that comes through war and defeating someone else. When I was growing up in the 70s and 80s, it was the Soviet Union. Today, it's ISIS. The world pretends that peace comes through expensive weaponry and torture and carpet bombing. But Jesus tells us that's not peace. That's merely the illusion of peace. The peace that Christ gives us is much more. The peace that Christ gives us is grounded in right relationship with God and all of God's people. The peace that Christ gives is the result of Jesus' commandment to love the Lord our God with all our heart, with all our strength, with all our might, and to love our neighbors as ourselves. That's where the peace of Christ comes from. Through our relationship with God and our relationship with one another. Relationships that are based on love, not fear or hatred. Relationships that respect the dignity of all people. Relationships which say we are willing to lay down our own lives that we might save them. And it is only through truly loving God and neighbor that we can experience that type of peace. Peace rather than fear. That peace which Jesus tells us is a gift. A gift. It's not something we can earn or achieve. It's a gift from God. This is Jesus' promise to his disciples. That in the midst of his departure, in the midst of his leaving, there is this peace of Christ that he gives to each and every one of us. This peace of Christ which can get us even through the most difficult situations. This peace of Christ which says that even though my body may be suffering from cancer or diabetes or Alzheimer's or Parkinson's or HIV, I can still have hope and be at peace in the Lord. This peace of Christ is a peace that says although we might see our children or our grandchildren going through painful, difficult times or through illness or divorce or addiction, nevertheless, in Christ Jesus, we can still find our peace. The peace of Christ, which says that as we lose a spouse or as a spouse approaches that time of life eternal, that yet we can still have peace because we have the peace of Christ in our hearts. The peace of Christ, which says it's not acceptable to allow fear to dictate our actions towards our neighbors or our foreign policy as a nation. The peace of Christ, which means it is not acceptable that the world live, two-thirds of the world live with barely enough to survive. And yet it does. Look around this room. Imagine if you got enough to eat today that the two people sitting behind you or in front of you or next to you wouldn't. Imagine that. So you see, the peace of Christ calls us to a new community which reflects the kingdom of God on earth. Every week we pray, and I'm sure many of you pray every day, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We pray it every week, but what does it mean? See, our goal is not world peace, I'd like to suggest. Our goal is God's peace in the world. And those are two different things. World peace is the idea of the absence of war, the absence of conflict, but that is such a minute part of the peace that Christ brings. The peace of Christ gathers us together in a new community where we share with one another, where we care for one another, where we come together and pray with one another and receive the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ together. That's the peace that only Jesus can give. The world cannot give us that peace. Only Jesus can and does. And that's the promise he gives to his disciples today. And not only to his disciples, but to each and every one of us who are God's children. The peace of Christ be with you. Not the peace that the world gives. The peace that God gives that we might live in the world as God's faithful children. To love the Lord with all our heart. To love our neighbors as ourselves. As Christ first called us, the peace of Christ be with us. Let us pray. Almighty God, in the midst of things we cannot understand, we can only rely and trust on your amazing grace and the peace that you promise us. Gracious God, in the midst of conflict, in the midst of war, in the midst of disease, in the midst of oppression, in the midst of injustice, in the midst of hunger and poverty, we are reminded constantly that this is not the way you desire the world to be. So you call us as your people to be agents of peace, to be peacemakers in the world, to walk in your light, to share in your love, to care for sisters and brothers, casting out all fear, that we might live in your peace and your peace alone. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Let us stand as we sing our hymn of the day together.